Announcements this morning. Staff parish is Tuesday at 6. Worship design and virtual night Bible study is on Wednesday, and the Board of Trustees will be meeting at 6 o'clock on Thursday. Our Kids Warm program is gearing up, and we are accepting new clothing. There will be containers by the front door, so if you want to drop anything off, you'll be greatly appreciated for the program. Anything else, Dick? Okay. Shall we bow our heads for an opening prayer? Oh God, you have promised that if we draw near to you, you will draw near to us. We ask that you prepare our hearts and prepare our minds, that we may receive your wisdom and understanding. Lord, pour out your spirit on each person here. Open us up to the words that you want us to hear and the lessons you want us to learn. In your Son's name, amen. Our opening hymn is Ye Servants of God.
Thank you. things get difficult, when we are called to do something which is hard for us, we shy away from the duty and the opportunity. We turn our back on service out of fear of failure. Forgive us, gracious Lord. Heal our fears and our weaknesses. Strengthen us and give us courage to truly be your disciples, not counting the rewards, but rejoicing in the work. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Do we have any kids to come out for children's time or adults? I don't care. We can all be kids sometimes, so Brody, your sister's not coming with you today. We're going to sit on the steps because I'm more comfortable that way. So we don't have a lot of kids here today, but if you guys remember, we have not had Sunday school for a couple of weeks because we had a COVID exposure. So today is actually our first day back. But Pastor Bob challenged our kids that received their Bibles a few weeks ago and the adults in the congregation to start reading the book of Mark. If you haven't gotten one of these blue, whatever it is, lists, you can get them out there on the table. But Brody, I know, has been very good at reading his scriptures for the week, haven't you? Yeah. So for week three, we read chapters 6 through 7 in the first part of 8. So Brody, what was your favorite part of these scriptures? That Jesus feeds 5,000. Why was that your favorite? Because he knows it. So it was familiar to read, hey? Do you think the book of Mark is easy to read? It is kind of easy to read. If you really haven't picked up your Bible in a long time, it's easy to read. There's so many little stories about the miracles that Jesus performed. So if you're behind, you can easily catch up because it's very easy to read. Any others, Brody, that you remember? Anything else that you really liked? That was the favorite one, and that's what Pastor Bob talked about last week. Well, as a mom, my favorite part of the story was when the disciples didn't wash their hands, and the Pharisees were like, what in the world are you doing? Your disciples aren't washing their hands before they eat. Do you remember what Jesus said? Do you remember what his response was? Yeah. Well, Jesus said, that's not God's rule, that's man's rule. What you put in your body does not make you evil. So, you know, you can eat whatever you want. Now, I'm saying that as a mom because we all want our kids to wash their hands before they eat. But we know that if you don't wash your hands before you eat, it's not going to make you into an evil person. That evil comes from the heart is what God was telling, or Jesus was telling the Pharisees. But they had to shoot him down somehow. So have you ever been really excited about something you did or accomplished, and then somebody that's maybe not really your friend or somebody that's jealous has something to say to you like, wow. Have you ever had that happen? Yeah. They just try to take the wind out of your sails, don't they? So the Pharisees were really upset because Jesus was doing all these miracles and he was having all these followers come, so they had to find something for him to say. But Jesus' comment was great. That's a man's law. That's not God's law. That is not in the Ten Commandments at all or any of the other laws that Jesus gave us. So go ahead and keep reading about Jesus' miracles and the things yet to come. It's going to start getting really exciting in the next few chapters. So Brody, I'm so thankful for you and your family. I know you're reading all the time. Are you reading by yourself or do you read with your parents? He reads by himself. So good job, Brody, and thanks for coming up.
From the book of Mark, chapter 9, 30 to 37. They went on from there and passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on our way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be the last of all and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it into his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." God's word.
Please pray with me. Father, please come to this place, clothe us with the Spirit, and clothe me. For the words I have written, I pray they are the words that you want them to hear. In your Son's name, amen. I read about a woman who had been trying for years and years to persuade her egotistical husband to change his ways. Now, he was obsessed with being number one. He never stopped talking about being number one in sales and number one in his office. He was always the first person to buy tickets for any event. He was always the first person to hit the parking lot after the game. He felt that he was the greatest person around. Does that sound familiar to any of you? Well, one day the man stopped on, he stepped onto one of those, you know, those weight machines that gives you your weight and gives you a little fortune. And so his wife stood back and watched him very intently. And he took the little card dropped out and it said, "You are a born leader with superior intelligence, quick wit, and charming manners. You have a magnetic personality and are very attractive to the opposite sex." Well, with just a little hint of gloating, he handed it to his wife and told her to read it. She did, and then she turned the card over and it said, "It's got your weight wrong too." So let's take a look, a closer look at the disciples of Jesus. A long time ago, someone in the church started calling them St. Jude, St. James, St. Matthew, St. Phillips. We have them all listed in our windows up there. And truly, these men must have had some outstanding qualities to have been chosen by Jesus. But in other ways, they were very human, just like you and me. I've got another story to tell you. The author, who is unknown, imagines taking a look at the disciples through the eyes of a business consulting firm. The report goes something like this. Memo to Jesus, son of Joseph, from the Jordan Management Consultants. Thank you for submitting the resumes of the 12 men you have picked for management positions in your new organization. Now, all of them have now taken our battery of tests And we have not only run the results through our computer, but have arranged personal interviews for each one of them. And our psychologist and vocational aptitude consultant, the profiles of all tests are included, and you will want to study them very carefully. As part of our service, we will make some general comments. These are given as a result of staff consultation and come without any additional fee. It is the opinion of the staff that most of your nominees are lacking background, education, and vocational aptitude for the type of enterprise you are undertaking. They do not understand the team concept, and we recommend you continue with your search. Now, Simon Peter is emotionally unstable and given to fits of temper, and Andrew has absolutely no qualities of leadership. The brothers, James and John, place personal interest above company loyalty. And Thomas has a skeptical attitude that would tend to undermine morale. It is our duty to tell you that Matthew has been blacklisted by the Greater Jerusalem Better Business Bureau. James, the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, have radical leanings and show a high score on the manic depressive scale. Only one of the 12 shows great potential. Guess who? He has the ability, resourcefulness, and a business mind. Meets people well. Is ambitious and highly motivated. We recommend Judas Iscariot as your controller and right-hand man. Now, isn't it amazing how Jesus chose the ordinary people to help accomplish his purpose? Did you listen to Jesus' dialogue in our gospel reading this morning? Jesus found a time when he was alone with his disciples, and he decided it was time to tell them a message they had heard before. The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And 3 days after being killed, he will rise again. That was from the Mark 31b that we had this morning. But Mark tells us they didn't understand what Jesus was talking about and were afraid to ask. Now, Mark doesn't tell us Jesus told them anything else. There was another time Jesus made this statement, and he had rebuked Peter for his worldly ways. Maybe they were afraid they would show their ignorance if they asked. Do you ever feel that way? Did you feel like you're being ignorant if you ask about a scripture or the meaning of a scripture? This time he just let them think over what he said. We don't know how much time passed, but it probably wasn't too long after that when they got to Capernaum. Now, evidently, they were having quite a heated discussion on the way because Jesus could hear them in the background. So Jesus asked them a very direct question. What were you arguing about on the way? Not one of them said a word, not one. But they were arguing among themselves about which of them was the greatest. Now you can hear the same attitude when children are arguing about the worldly things in life. Little kids argue, my folks are richer than your folks. Teenagers make statements like, our team could beat your team any day of the week. And then adulthood finds people saying, I'm the boss, and it's going to be my way or else. All three of those statements made at different stages of life are used to elevate one person and devaluate the other person. When the disciples refused to answer Jesus, he sat down and called the 12 to him. Then he said in verse 35, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant to all." Now we also hear these very same words in Mark 10:43, Matthew 20:26, and Luke 22:26. Then Christ brought a little child into their midst and took it in his arms, and more divine wisdom poured forth from verse 37. "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." Beautiful words. Jesus wanted his disciples to identify with the child instead of power and prestige. Greatness was being last. Greatness is being a servant, and having faith like a little child is much better. But most of us from experience feel that kind of attitude isn't going to cut it in the real world. If we live the way Jesus is talking about, we are going to feel used, manipulated, and jerked around. So Jesus' answer to us would be something maybe like this. "Yes, I know the servant mode of living isn't easy, but I also know this is the right way. This is the way of God's people." Think about the reading, there's a reading in James where he talks about wisdom. Now the dictionary defines wisdom as that which is true, right, or lasting. And God's word is a little more extensive in the definition of wisdom. James 3:13 says, "Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness born of wisdom." And then James goes on to say in verses 17 and 18 of chapter 3, "But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without a trace of partiality or hypocrisy. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace for those who make peace." Friends, there's enough details in that definition to write a book. And God did. The way of Jesus is divine wisdom. It is distinct from earthly wisdom that causes envy and selfish ambition, that leads to disorder and wickedness of every kind. Those who follow Christ must be willing to lose their life for others. True wisdom is the divine gift that leads to peace. However, this is only possible when people submit to God. Whoever remains a friend of the world is an enemy of God. Mark's gospel tells us Jesus found this worldly understanding of things in his disciples. Much better than the fake resume from that company earlier. Jesus also glorifies the distinction of being a servant. Worldly standards tell us we should strive to hire servants and not be a servant. Jesus reverses this way of thinking. Only those who are willing to serve others can find greatness. That is the way Christ lived every day. Now, his is an example to each one of his followers. And when you and I want to serve God, we must be willing to serve everyone. Everyone. Besides being last and willing to be a servant, we must also be like a little child. He was talking about being childlike, not childish. And there is a big difference. The three examples I gave you earlier in this message were childish. And a child is unable to conceal its thoughts, feelings, and simplicity of life. Children have a sense of awe and wonder about life, and they can forgive and love. They have the capacity to learn and to be taught. And as we become adults, we place a protective coating of distrust over ourselves. We build up walls and build powerful weapons to protect ourselves from others and from being hurt. I don't know about any of you guys, but I sure have been there. I put one brick and another brick and another brick right around that heart of mine. Took a long time to tear it down. In closing this message, I am asking that you take the words of Jesus home with you. Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant to all. And remember, Jesus was holding a little child on his lap while he was speaking. God loves you, and so do I. Amen. This time we'll have a hymn, Tell Me the Stories of Jesus.
She was in the hospital. She's home and healing well. God is good
all the time.
Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning with thankfulness and praise in our hearts for all you have given us. And we ask that you grant us the rest we need to rejuvenate our body and our spirit during the coming week. Hear our prayers, O Lord, as we surrender them per our prayer request of joy and concerns into your capable hands. And we also lift up unspoken prayers that lay on our hearts. We remember those who are not with us this morning for unknown reasons and ask that you watch over them. In the precious name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, we pray. In the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. It's time now for our invitation to give. There is plates in the back as you leave that you can drop it in. Plus, we have been receiving online and through the mail, and we would like to lift those up now to our Father. Son's name.
Yeah. Go for the benediction. And I should have spoken earlier. Relative to Project Keep Kids Warm, that kind of caught me off guard this morning, and I'm usually not one that has my tongue tied, but the program is underway, and I think all of you in our congregation know that we're, because of COVID, we changed our plan, our venue quite a bit last year. We're now working with the school systems to identify children and respond to them. And that program is going to go on all winter, so we won't have the collection as we've done in the past for many, many years. This is number 12, by the way. This is the 12th year that this church has sponsored Project Keep Kids Warm. We won't have the free shopping day at the Ishpeming Armory, but I repeat, we'll be distributing clothing to children as we identify them all winter long. So what can you do with this change in the venue? As Paulette mentioned earlier, we have our collection box out, and we also have them in a number of locations throughout Ishpeming and Nagani, including our wonderful church that supports us at Emmanuel Lutheran. New clothing donations can come in. But if that's not convenient for you, then we're accepting financial donations. And I will be going out on a media campaign now the rest of this month, asking the general public for media and new clothing donations so that we can support those kids. And those checks can be made out to Wesley United Methodist Church, not Project Keep Kids Warm. We have to make them out to our church. And they'll go into our fund, and 100% of that money goes to purchasing new clothes that'll support those kids. So thank you for your help on Project Keep Kids Warm.
Thank you. Well, as we leave today, just remember the wisdom that God grants you to go out and serve others and be kind. Always be kind. Even though they're not kind to you, be kind to them. Go in peace and serve your Lord.